I'm EAC Commissioner Christy McCormick. The EAC's annual National Clearinghouse Awards, also known as the Clearies, recognize best practices in election administration. This year, the EAC commissioners are interviewing some of the 2020 Clery winners to get more information on their award-winning programs and highlight these best practices for election officials across the country. Today, I'm pleased to speak with Gary Sims, Director of Elections for the Wake County Board of Elections in North Carolina. The Wake County Board of Elections won a 2020 Clery for best practices in recruiting, retaining, and training poll workers for the program Coffee with Nick. Congratulations, Mr. Sims, and thank you for joining me.
I am very happy to be here today. Thank you very much for having me.
Great. Well, to start, can you give us a brief overview of the Coffee with Nick program that you used in 2020?
Yeah, so with us, it seemed like such a simple, small idea, but we had to address the big problem. We had already, in 2020, the primaries have been moved to March permanently in North Carolina even years. And so we had already started with a web-based training program only as an emergency program, just knowing that in North Carolina, there's always a chance you can get an ice storm in January or February, knowing that we could have a primary and we would still need to do training. But we were really thinking small at that time. In North Carolina, March 3rd, the pandemic hit. For the first time in Wake County, we were actually the first. And coincidentally, it hit on our primary day when the first case came out that afternoon. And we were actually running an election that day. So things started ramping up pretty quick from there. And no matter what, we knew we were going to have the November election, the same as every elections county. And we were a little bit nervous because our poll workers started asking us questions. How are you going to deal with this? What are we going to do? The questions were just coming in so much. And I kind of, you know, like taking things head on and go ahead and be proactive and work with. I met with our staffing team here and we looked at all of our options. And it had always been just kind of a joke. I mean, we have a staff member on our staffing team. His name is Nick, and you know, he didn't want to be in front of the camera. I said, well, we're gonna start a program. We're gonna call it the Coffee with Nick. But then the idea took off. I said, wait a second, this may be a good idea. Our team, we just had some brainstorming. We knew that we had to get our officials comfortable with web-based training. That was the bottom line. But we were nervous about how that was gonna happen whenever a lot of the officials that we work with, they may not have been comfortable with online training programs. So we had to make sure we created an environment where it was no pressure, no stress. And really our goal was to just help them troubleshoot how to connect, you know, how to ask a question. And that really was where it started, was just something informal. And I knew I had myself to get out there in front of it because we had a lot of people that were nervous and afraid and unsure what was going to happen in 2020. So we decided to take it head on. I decided that we were going to hit that thing at the very beginning and start answering questions, be direct. And it evolved into something I had no idea it would grow to. The number of participants, and we were able to start working on mostly answering questions instead of one by one, addressing everything head on, letting everybody know where we were at in the pandemic, what we were working on, what we were developing, our plans, and our community just grew. It was started out with our precinct officials that we had traditionally been working with. And then as we got in new people to sign up, that it gave them an introduction to the Board of Elections because we were used to having training and working hand in hand with our officials, but we were losing that connection. And, you know, anybody that works in elections, I don't care what your job is, you know, the value of what we do are our people, our elections officials out there working in the precincts, early voting. We want to make sure we maintain that connection because they're like family to us. And it really gave us an opportunity in a no pressure environment. And what happened was people became very comfortable using our platform. People became, they knew that they can ask a question. We were going to get back with them. It just, the number of questions that were coming in, and people were actively engaging, reading, and just really getting involved in everything that was going on. And it led to, I have to say, you know, the, probably our most successful training season after that. Very much people engaged. People did everything they can to reach out to us and with us. And we even had officials come back, reach out back to us and said, thank you very much for doing that, because it allowed me to interact with my grandchildren during this. So it was.
I mean, we forget that a year ago, most of us didn't really use these platforms, Zoom and Microsoft Teams and all these different kinds of online chat functions. And so getting people to understand how to use it was something that, you know, was a big step. So.
Yeah. And it was a win. And matter of fact, it was such a win that we're not stopping. People now, they'll take off of work just to tune in for that. And we always make them short, and we value their time that they're investing with us. It has grown so much more because with so much misinformation and disinformation out there in the elections world, we mm-hmm. realized that this was our strongest community to help us get the correct information out there to the community. And the value of that in itself was just priceless.
So what challenges did you face in developing and implementing this program?
Scale was the biggest thing. Most platforms that people do work off of, it is based on, you know, typically 100, 500 viewers. So we had to scale up some of our operations. We went with, and again, I'm not promoting it because there's a lot of platforms out there, but for us, Zoom webinar worked best for us. We found that we could deliver and we can manage those meetings, because you couldn't just go live with 800, 900 people in a meeting. So we had to make sure that we had a platform, but it allowed them to enter questions for us to answer those questions live and engage with people. So we were able to scale up using Zoom webinar, which we were already using for some of our web-based board meetings mm-hmm. and other various meetings. And again, we had already went into that program with the thought of, if we have snow or ice and we need to do training, we need to prepare for it. So cost was really pretty much always there with us. So I almost want to say the cost was nothing to us, simply because we were already working with an emergency plan for training if necessary. And so the cost itself, that was not a limitation. It was little bitty things that we had to get used to also, because what it did, it allowed our staff that were actually going to be doing the actual training. That was another side benefit for us, because they got the hands-on experience by participating in these in a live setting. Because mm-hmm. any of you know that when you're working on a presentation, you got to figure out where your camera is, what your sound going to be. Unfortunately, some of us may be challenged on top with hair, even working with the glare of a light in a room. So there were so many logistical issues that it not only solved for our officials, but it also solved for us. We had to prepare to train over 2,400 election day officials.
Well, you know, that's right. People don't realize how many people it takes to run elections, and are shocked sometimes to hear how many short-term hires you have to make in order to pull off an election. And that's a lot of people.
Absolutely. And that's one of the benefits. And that's another side benefit, I think, to this whole thing is we need to, if anybody working in elections is thinking that the time to engage with your elections officials is the month or two before an election, you need to change that mindset.
Right.
Needs to be 12 months a year. You need to be engaging with individuals, keeping in touch with them, whatever you've got to do. So work on building that community mm-hmm. and what is going to help you with retention. It's going to help individuals feel like they're part of the program. And that's has to be one of the best parts is they are part of our program. We answer their questions. We tell them what we do. And we thought they would be bored out of their mind when people start talking about elections, but it's only growing for us. More and more people are tuning in now to our continued shows because they want to know what's going on. We're doing a show. Our next show coming up is going to be talking about voting equipment and the security protocols that we put in with voting equipment, how we test and guaranteed. But we've already got around 1,000 people signed up for that.
It's amazing. This last couple of years, the increase in the interest in how elections are run. I mean, I've been in this business for quite a long time, and I've never seen so many people so interested in how elections are run and what we do behind the scenes. And of course, I think transparency is really important on elections. So this just, you know, strengthens the transparency, letting people understand how we do it, how it functions, what needs to be done. It's not a, you know, simple pull a machine out, take a vote. It's a huge enterprise.
Right. And we want it to be right. We're going to do it right.
It has to be right.
Right. We don't, failure's not our option. And, right. You know, so why not engage with your officials? And whether or not you're using a program like this or any other program, that's the best message I can get out there is, how can you not afford to do this? Right. How can you not afford to engage with your officials? Again, they're on the front lines out there. We depend on them. They do an amazing job. Their dedication and commitment is, you know, nobody will even understand. Unless you work in elections, you'll just never understand what goes into it to make things work.
Did you get any feedback from the election staff or voters over this program that you'd be willing to share with us?
It was so much. I mean, the most important part, I think some of the biggest, was the individual contributions back with our staff members, directly communicating with them via email or phone calls, just saying thank you so much. And the biggest, you know, some of the things that we get from it is, you know, I took what you talked about in your program, and I was able to explain this to my uncle who really believes in social media or, you know, bad news references to stuff. But I was able to explain to him in detail how this works. So it's our officials. You know, we got some that's been working with us for close to 30 years at this point. And they just come back and say, you know, I never knew. And that is some of the biggest helps to us, because when they're out there working, they don't want to say, well, how can you guarantee my vote's going to count? They want to be able to say, actually, I can guarantee this because A, B, C, and D.
Right.
And that's
it gives them the knowledge to back up the answers.
Absolutely. And I think in this day and time, how can you afford not to do that? You know, even if you're in a smaller county, you're going to have to get out there now, and you're going to have to make sure that you are building that confidence in the
community. That's exactly right.
So, you know, why not?
That's the biggest concern, right? At this point, is confidence in our elections and making sure that we keep that confidence and answer the questions that people have. So I know you started this kind of as a limited sort of program, but now you're talking about doing it all the time. Where do you see this program, Coffee with Nick, going in the future?
You know, we keep doing it. Each time we're making little edits, we're really making it more of an interactive, you know, show that, you know, more really like almost like a nighttime talk show type environment. And again, just making sure it's a casual, we also want to make sure people do want to come back. So we'll really make sure the value's there. We're going to keep going with it. With us, it's part of our regular program. Right now we're doing them monthly, but as we get closer to the upcoming municipal elections this year, we'll be, you know, picking up the pace a little bit more, talking more about special topics and things that are going to be going on, because, you know, remember, we're still in a pandemic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we, you know, while we may be getting vaccinated or, you know, making sure we're feeling better, we're still potentially could be conducting elections coming up still in an environment where we need to make sure we're making all preparations and taking all the precautions we should be doing. So our staff, they've already committed. They said that even after I retire, this is part of what's going to be happening here in Wake County. And we've actually got some, I'm not going to reveal them right now, but we're ready for a couple more Cleary submissions that we got planned. We're kicking off some programs this year as well. So we're going to be even talking about that in some of our future shows.
So I noticed in the materials that you all submitted that this really helped with poll worker recruitment as well. As we know, I mean, the EAC ran a National Poll Worker Recruitment Day this year, first time ever we've done that, because we've heard so often from election officials how difficult it is to recruit poll workers and election officials to help in the elections. So how did this help you increase your recruitment numbers?
I think it built the community. People knew what they were going to get into. If you think about it, when people first sign up, they really don't know what they're signing up for. You know, mm-hmm. here it is, we're saying, okay, we want you to work, take all this training, set up the Monday before the election that night and get up at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning and give us a good 15, 16 hour day. And then
we'll pay you a couple quarters to do that.
And we're going to pay you barely enough to cover your breakfast, lunch, and dinner
for
that. And so, you know, but the reality is most of our officials, I think they would do it for free, but the truth is it built that community and helped when those new officials came in, they didn't want to run away because we were letting them know what to expect. Mm-hmm. They knew they were a part of a community. It wasn't just one person sitting there signing up. We had some people come back and told us, they said, well, you know, I was watching your show and a friend of mine was asking what I was doing. And I sent them the link and they tuned in. And next thing you knew, they signed up to be precinct officials also. So again, it was, I think the biggest
help spread the word.
It did. And people were able to say, hey, I work in elections. I've never done it before, but I've learned all this stuff. And people, they said, well, I want to go learn that too. And another great thing about it is our younger generation that we're constantly trying to recruit for to work the polls. They're used to this. They're used to
the technology.
Exactly. It wasn't inconvenient for them. And so they come to expect it. So they don't, we need to adjust. If we're going to be working to recruit a new generation of poll workers, we need to be prepared and adjust for that new group because they're connected. And they do things differently. You know, mm-hmm. I may be used to reading a book or a manual. They want it delivered to them differently. And so that's where, you know,
you're so right.
We need to make sure we're keeping up with the times. And that's the great, I'm very fortunate. I got a great staff I work with. This was not me sitting down saying, let's just do this. This really was a whole office process to develop. It really involved every single section of our office, even people that don't work with training. Everybody got engaged. Everybody's still engaged with this. It wasn't just a one-person, two-person show. It really took our entire office, and I think it's one of the greatest things we've done, and actually it's fun. That's the great thing about it, and we get to engage with people that we genuinely do love, the same as our family out there.
So what recommendations would you give to jurisdictions smaller or larger than yours if they want to implement something similar?
Baby steps. Right now, there's many platforms out there that are actually free. Like I said, do some research. We did find that Zoom webinar worked better for us, especially early on when people were just doing Zoom meetings. You may have to make a small investment, but you may find that it's still going to pay off if you're able to use it in other ways just as much. You don't have to go as large scale as us, so they do have cheaper plans. So just make sure you do your research or check with your county. There may be resources already being used. You may be able to use some of those resources with them. Get a plan. Even in our Cleary submission, we didn't try to, you know, we started out our first show. It was kind of probably wasn't, you know, perfect. And I think we really worked to refine it. You can, we actually put our links in our Cleary submission. You can see some of our wins. Yep. You can see some of our fails. We put it out there, and that was the biggest thing, is making sure that, what is your plan? A really important thing is make sure you have moderators. Okay. So even for this call, we have somebody moderating to make sure everything goes smoothly. And I think that's really important, is don't just sit there and click on it and you got to run it. Make sure you understand your transitions. If you're going to have videos or PowerPoint presentations, so many people did move to online types of training. So rehearse. We do several rehearsal shows before we actually go live, just to make sure the videos work, the presentations, to make sure we, because it's really important that we keep these times short. We really work them at about 30 minutes, you know, not to waste people's time, and also to make sure we're keeping with the proper amount of attention that people would want to dedicate to a program like that. So make it fun. Start out with a small group of people. Maybe you've got a handful of chief judges or officials that you work with out there, and make it small. Tell them what you're going to be doing, and you might be surprised that they may even be willing to help you out or even make some presentations for you. So engage with those people out there that you trust, you can replicate anything. You can deliver the message. And I think the biggest thing is, you're going to be surprised if you do this, people are going to tune in. Mm-hmm. We just thought, wow, we don't know what to expect, but it's overwhelming. And the thing is, we record them, so people then go back. Our audience, we get probably 50 to 100 emails after saying, I'm so sorry I missed the show. Can you please send me the link? We want to make sure. And also make them productive. Develop some FAQs. When they ask a question, try to get to those questions, but make sure you have a mechanism where you can go back and answer those questions for those individuals, because they're going to have questions. Figure out how to summarize them and make sure you get them out there, whether or not it's an email distribution list or if you have a site set up just for your elections officials. Make sure they understand that you care enough to answer those questions back to them, and let them know fairly. It's going to take you a little bit to kind of get the questions in a format and get them properly answered and get them back to them, and they'll appreciate it, and communicate with all of them whenever you do that. So same as we want to be transparent in elections, we want to make sure that we are being transparent and open and engaging with our elections officials that we're out there working with as well.
They're our best advocates, really.
Absolutely. And so, like I said, we love them. So
you said that you're going to have some more Cleary submissions for us. We're looking forward to that. Without giving too much away, what's next for the Wake County Board of Elections?
Right now, we had 182 student election assistants. These are people that were qualified by law, that were 17 or older, but they weren't registered to vote. They were students. They got permission to work. 182 of these young individuals helped us out last year. They became elections officials. We need to, I don't want to give too much away. We're developing a program to work with those individuals to be ambassadors in the community, and also to give them the proper recognition, because this is the group we've been looking for. This is the future. And if we can get them involved, engaged, part of the community, we may have an elections official working with us for the next, you know, 40, 50 years. Or not they go to college in a different county, a different state, or, you know, or even move away from here, it's a great way. And these were just, we could not have done it without them. They were fearless. They were out there, and they helped us out so much. So that's what they were part of the reason we were fully staffed during early voting and election day last year in a pandemic. These young citizens, these young future voters were so much critical. So we want to make sure that we reach out and engage with those individuals and see what else we can do it to expand that program.
That sounds fantastic. I mean, you know, get them in early. Once you get into elections, it's hard to ever leave elections. Yeah. So, you know, it sounds like a great program. Looking forward to hearing more details.
Yeah, I think it's going to be great. We're actually in discussions with that right now. So, like I said, I think you're going to look at it next year and go, okay, yeah, he was right. You know, that was a good idea. But again, I think, you know, that's why I love the clearies. We read every single one of them that mm-hmm. are submitted because we
some great ideas.
You could say we're stealing your ideas, but if you put it out,
that's what we want.
We're borrowing it from you, and we appreciate it.
That's the whole point.
Absolutely, and that's why we put ours out there too. Because sometimes something so simple, something so small, can make such a huge impact.
Absolutely. Well, congratulations on winning a Cleary this year. We look forward to your next year submissions and a little bit later this year, actually. And thank you so much for joining me today. I think this is a really interesting conversation, and I think other folks will get, election folks will get some good information out of it. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much. And it is a honor to meet you, and I hope you stay well and be safe.
You too. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.